A very good morning to all the participants who have joined us from all over the world. Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the time zones. It's a privilege to be hosting Maria today, who will be speaking on short lessons on the etymology of prokaryotic species, especially when Latin is not your mother tongue. Dr. Maria Chuvochina is working at Australian Center for Ecogenomics at the University of Queensland. Maria is a molecular biologist who turned herself into one of the internationally recognized experts on prokaryotic nomenclature, following her interest in the formation and application of names. She obtained her doctoral degree in 2011 from the Nuclear Physics Institute in Russia and the University of Grenoble in France. She further acquired most of her professional experience at the University of Queensland in Australia, where she still works as a principal taxonomic curator of the GTDB. We've already had an inaugural session. Our first inaugural session was by Phil Hugenholz, who've spoken a lot about GTDB and what it is doing and how is it shaping the field of uncultivated microorganisms and organisms that are known from genomic sequences. The next one is, so for GTDB, she overviews all nomenclature related issues and assists in development and validation of curation tools and criteria. Maria is also a member of the Judicial Commission of International Committee on Systematics of Prokaryotes, and she also played a critical role in the development of the recently established C code, which is aimed to facilitate naming specifically for the uncultured taxa. And together with Professor Phil Hugenholz and the rest of the GTDB team, she continues to pursue the goal of unified taxonomic framework for all prokaryotic taxa. And with this brief introduction, I'll invite Maria to please share her screen and start her session. Participants will take the question answer sessions at the end of the talk, and please post your questions in the Q&A box.
Thanks a lot for inviting me to talk about the etymology of prokaryotic species. It's really a privilege to join the BISMiS session. And first of all, okay, that's nice. Okay, yeah, so what I'm going to talk about, first of all, I'm going to introduce myself and give brief introduction, what is this talk about? Then I'm going to move to the art of scientific naming, and we're going to talk about whether names have meanings or not and what those meanings are. And then we're going to look at the different formation rules of prokaryotic names, some basic ones, different sources of names. And we're going to see how prokaryotic nomenclature is moving towards standardization and uniformity in nomenclature formation. And we will talk then about the future of scientific naming and microbiology, and I will conclude with some remarks. So, do you enjoy languages and playing with words and checking the meanings? Perhaps you speak more than one language like I do. And I believe as a scientist, we're always looking for meanings and we're trying to assign those meanings to the work we're doing. So, but this talk is not about psychology or philosophy of science, it's about etymology. And the etymology, the definition of it's in the brief, it's a study of the true sense of a word. And please don't be confused with entomology, with the study of the insect. So when I introduce myself to people, when I say, oh, my name is Masha, first of all, what they think about is this character, which is probably kind of similar to me, but not really. But what is true is that I'm also coming from the land of the bears, and I wanted to share with you this little video about Kamchatka. So that's the land where I was born, and I lived there for 14 years, and I believe it's a really beautiful place. Unfortunately, now very hard to visit. Sous un manteau de froid. that's Kamchatka, that's peninsula where I'm from in Russia. And let me see, how can I move to my next slide? Okay, so how did it bring me to nomenclature? Well, as Kamlesh already tell a little bit about me, but I will expand it more. So I'm a biologist and I graduate from the Department of Biology. My major was in biochemistry at the Cuban State University, not in Cuba, unfortunately, but in Russia. And then in 2007, I started my PhD at the St. Petersburg Nuclear Physics Institute in under the program of French government, which called Co-Tutel. So I also did part of my PhD at University of Grenoble. And that's allowed me to get a double beige degree from Russian Academy of Science and University of Grenoble. Then in 2011, I moved to Australia, where I worked as a postdoc and a tutor of microbiological courses. And then I had a short break, got a kid. And in 2016, Phil Guggenhall suggested me to join his new project. And that's how GDDB began. So while enjoying GDDB, we realized straight away that when we're shuffling different taxa and we're changing the taxonomic borders, we need to express this. And the way to express it to the community is via the language. And this language has official rules. So we didn't know that at the time at all. And I started to be curious about it because as a database and the resource, well, that was actually was before we put database on. So I wanted to know more about formation of name. And we were thinking that we could actually create a tool that would allow us to propagate names from the genus up to the higher rank. And in 2015, I found this editorial from IGSM where they were calling for young microbiologists to join the nomenclature review team. And I contacted Aaron Oren and he suggested, yeah, you can join. We're gonna make a little test. So he tested my knowledge of Latin or better say orthography rules of formation of name and he was satisfied. And in 2016, I joined the IGSM nomenclature review boards. Unfortunately, I didn't serve for long because that was quite a lot of work, I realized. But I still stay in touch with nomenclature and people would ask me from time to time their advices for name information. Then in 2020, I joined ICSP because we realized that there is a need to revise current rules and there is a need to modernize prokaryotic nomenclature so that it's getting scalable with the needs of modern microbiology. And that's how in 2020, we started the C-Code initiative about which I will talk a bit later on. So let's move to the art of scientific naming. I really like this paper from William Kent. I invite you to read it. You can find it and download easily. So William Kent from University of Utah wrote this article about scientific naming where he talks about the meanings of name and he talking about the different concepts comparing to scientists, Lavoisier and Faraday, where Lavoisier, French chemist, thought that, well, names should be really fixing the meaning, while Faraday was so anxious. He didn't like, he thought, well, you know, meanings evolve and how can we call these things something? Because in the next like couple of years, its meaning can be totally changed. So he thought, well, names should be totally meaningless. So where is the truth for taxonomy, taxonomic names? Are they meaningful or meaningless? And if we talk about the etymology of names and whether the etymology have meanings, well, they do, but when they apply to names, do they actually have any meaning? Let's have a look, for example, at, you know, famous E. coli. We know that E. coli harbors strain that possess different features and you have commensal E. coli, you have those that are causing urinary tract infections. So shall we change the name, you know, each time like it's adding new strain and new properties? Probably not. And same for the higher taxa. So on a right here, you see example from the higher taxa, specifically cyanobacteria phylum. And not long time ago, There were a couple of lineages added to cyanobacteria that are non-photosynthetic. And therefore, shall we change the name of a phylum? Probably not, because it doesn't really matter if we add in new knowledge. You know, new knowledge evolves, but the names, they're just a label. So if we look at the true purpose of names, it's actually just an anchor for a name, and it's not really indicator of its character or history of the taxon, because those things evolving. When we add in new knowledge, new characters, and that's all evolved. So there is no really meaning in a name when we name it. And if we, you know, if we want to say, oh, that's, I don't know, purple bacteria, because it's forming some purple colonies, but then there would be other strain, they might not form those. So it's, in this sense, it's really meaningless. So the only meaning it has, it depends on which category you're actually talking about, whether it's a species, genus, family, or the class of phylum. And then the name information rules follow from those. So if we look at species and genus names, this actually requires a bit of a mental exercise, because you need to know a little bit of Latin grammar and you need to think about the sources of the name. While if you want to form new name at the higher taxa level, family, order, class of phylum, that's pretty straightforward. And the only thing which might require a little bit of work from your side is to figure out what the stem of the type genus, so then the standard suffix can be added to it. So let's have a look at the naming process. You know, where it's starting and how the meanings, let's say, evolve for the name. So first of all, we define in the taxon boundaries, and then we check in based on the boundaries under which category it falls. So we can look at the formation rules and start forming our name. So let's say if it's a species, subspecies, or genus, the formation rules are different. Then we start exploring the ideas and sources from which the name can come from. It could be coming from the characters that you see. It could be coming from some metabolic reconstructions, depending whether you're dealing with a culture or non-cultured organism. And once you come with the idea, then you start forming your name. It could be single stem or multiple stem name, and you have to look at the derivation of the stem and you're assigning a gender. And then the last step, you check for uniqueness. So perhaps that name already exists. You know, it's you're not the only one who thought about designing such a name. And the last step would be type designation, which is entity to which we attach the name. So whether it's a strain or whether it's a genome sequence or it's a type species of the genus. And then you name it. Bingo. For the higher taxa, as I said, it's a little bit easier. So again, yeah, we're defining the boundary of the taxa, and then once we know which category we're dealing with, or the family, class, or phylum, then we check the formation rules in ICNP or SIC code. And next step will be check whether within those boundaries there is actually any existing types already, because if there is already type, genus for another higher taxon, then you should normally apply the name of that higher taxon. If not, you designated new type genus for this taxon. And then the names follow from this type genus. And you name it. Okay. So there are different reasons for forming new names. It's not only new descriptions when you discover something, new organisms, but it could be also resulting from the reclassifications. For example, when the taxon is divided, one portion is keeping its type and therefore the name, and then another portion should be given new name, and that new name, you will start again the process. You will designate the type, and you, if it's a genus, it will be new genus. If it's a higher rank taxon, you designate the type genus and you derive a name from it. New names are also resulted from the transfers. So when that species is transferred into a new genus, you create a new combination, and that's a new name. If you change the rank, for example, you lower the species to the level of subspecies, you form a new name. So that's some of the reasons why we would need a new name. Or if you unite the taxa, sometimes you just need to select name dependent on priority. So there you don't really need any name information. Okay, so let's have a look what resources we have out there that could help us in formation of prokaryotic names. Some of the classic ones are coming from Hans Trooper, How to Name a Prokaryote, and Aaron Oren, not long time ago, updated this chapter and he wrote in the Berger Manual a chapter called How to Name New Taxa of Archaean Bacteria, and invite you to read this article. That's really, really useful. And provide you a lot of information about how to form new names, genera, and species. And then we have plenty of recommendations and rule in Appendix 9 of ISMP, Appendix of Orthography, as well as there is heaps of information currently at LPSN. If you go to LPSN DSMZ etymology, you would also find a range of resources that will help you with name information. Right, so let's start with some simple formation rules. And I just wanted to show you the differences between between names that are formed from the roots that are not changing and roots that are changing. For the higher taxa name. So I will start with higher taxa because I think that's the simplest example. So here on the left, for example, you have the Candidatus pinnataceae. So you could see that that name is formed from the type genus of this family called Binatus and the suffix which indicate that this is a family, atsa, that's a standard suffix. So how do we know that it should be not binatusatia, but it should be binatatia? Well, to do that, we need to define the stem of binatus. And what is the stem of binatus? Okay, let's have a look. So binatus is actually a compound name. It is consisting of two stems. It is a Latin adverb bis, meaning twice, and it consists of another Latin muscular adjective, natus. Here, we need a little bit of help from the Latin dictionaries to see what is the genitive declension of the natus. And if we go to the dictionary, we see, okay, that's nati. And to find out the root, the stem of natus, what we have to do, we have to decline it in genitive and we drop the ending. Okay, nat. So that's our root, nat. So next step, now we know the root of binatus, so that will be binat, and then we add in atsea, and that gives us binatatse. But then there are other cases like iramanadatse, where the stem of the type genus is actually not the same, but it has different different structure, I would say, or different letters. From its original form. So Iramonadatse is formed from its type genus Iramonas and again suffix atsa. And Iramonas is also a compound name, which is formed from the word ir and monas. And again, the exercise we're doing is the same. We find in the word monas in a dictionary and we look at the genitive case. The genitive case is monadis. We're dropping the ending and we get in the stem, monad. Okay, so how we form this name? Aramonadatsia. So to the monad, we add in atsa. So it's not going to be aramonasatsia, but aramonadatsia. I hope you get it. And there are many examples like this, where some of the words will have quite different stems in a genitive cases. And when we're forming higher taxa names, we always have to check whether the type genus and its last compound names have different stem compared to the nominative case. Okay, so now let's move to the genus. So genus names could be formed from the single stem or it could be combined stem. In a single stem example, like it's really easy. So here one name I choose, it's a very beautiful name, I think. It's Melitea, named after Melit, a nymph of the sea in Greek mythology. So the way to Latinize it's just to add the A here. And there are rules to Latinize personal name, and names of mythological creatures also fall under personal name or proper nouns. Then if we look at the compound names, or names, generic names that are formed with combined stems, here it's getting a little bit complicated. Because again, we need to derive the stem of each individual word in order to join them together and to create generic name. So in this example, I choose generic name Tesulfo-Halafiprio, and it is composed of the prefix Tesulfa, which is itself formed from the prefix de and noun sulfur, and two other stem hals from Greek hals and vibrio. So how do we combine the soul together? You could see that between hals and vibrio, we have connected vowel O. And this is because hals, it's a Greek word. So orthography tell us, appendix 9, the ISNP, tell us that if the precedent element from the terminus is Greek, of a Greek origin, then connecting vowel is O. If this word will be Latin, that connecting vowel will be I. And if the following words start with the vowel, then we actually don't need any connecting vowel, because that will create a little bit of Right. So now let's have a look at the species. Species are binomial, thanks to Linnaeus, who introduced us to the system. And here is a wonderful marsupial, and it's famous gut microbiome member, which called Lampinella calarum. And that names come from the Lone Pine Sanctuary here in Brisbane. So the name consists, the species name consists of two parts, genus and specific epithet. So we already had a look at the genus name. And another thing I didn't tell you about, that generic name, they're always Latin noun in the nominative case, regardless how you like, you take, you can maybe take adjectives or verbs to form it, but at the end of the day, it's always Latin noun in the nominative case, and the ending should be as well. And specific epithet can be formed in three different ways. It could be adjective, which is agrees in gender with generic names. And this is quite common case for most of the specific epithet. It could be also noun in a position, which is a bit rare case, but we do have such examples. Or it could be noun in genitive case, which is also quite common case. So here, koalarum is actually noun in genitive case, meaning of koalas. And yeah, mind, that's actually plural. Yeah, so it's of koalas, not of one, because it's found in all koalas and not in other marsupials, apparently. So quite unique. Then here there is a subspecies name. So subspecies names, very similar to species, except that it consists of three words and subspecies abbreviation in between. And subspecific epithets are formed in the same way as specific epithets. So you could have all of these three different kinds of formations. Right. And actually, yeah, it's Salvibrio mixtus. It's a species that has been named by Linda Blackall, who works in the University of Queensland in 1985, yeah, when I was born. Right. So etymology and taxonomic descriptions. How do we frame it? Okay, when we describe new taxon, we usually ask you, at least in IGSM, we ask you to provide a description of new taxa that starts with etymology, where you provide a name. And if it's a new genus and new species, you start with the genus first, then it comes to the species. So I again have an example of Lampinella. And if we look at the practical side of etymology, it's usually start with syllabification, also showing the accent where it should be put. Then we will have what the language is coming from. In this case, well, it's NL stands for New Latin, because that's not Latin itself, Lampinella, since it has been formed from the Lone Pine Sanctuary. And of course, that name doesn't exist in Latin. So we Latinize it and we call it New Latin. We provide the gender, femina, and here it's dim. The abbreviation stands for diminutive because it has the suffix ella, and it's a noun. As I told you, all genus should be a noun Okay, and then it's followed by the translation. So what Lepinella means, it actually means it's an organism named after the lone pike koala sanctuary, private zoo here in Australia. Same you could see here for Kalarum. So we provide the syllabification, the language, and yeah, and translation of it. So that's pretty basics. And normally all different journals, they have different styles except IGSM. So IGSM has really defined style for etymology, and you have to follow this because then it's become really easy for reviewers, especially for nomenclature reviewers, to check the etymology rather than having it in all around the place. Okay, so let's have a look at the most common terminus of prokaryotic names. I have to say big thanks to our PhD students and a member of GDB team, Aaron, because he was really kind and he generated the snide word class for me. I asked him to do this morning, actually. So what we could see here is the most common terminus that I used. Oh, sorry. My screen is going off and on. Okay, most common terminus that they used in prokaryotic names. And the source of these roots are taken from LPSN. So thanks a lot, LPSN. It's really great. We could get so much information from you. So it's interesting because you see that, yeah, bacterial names are quite heavily populated with certain terminals, such as monas. You could see that's most popular for the prokaryotic names in the feminine gender. Virga, cella. For the masculine gender, we'll see that bacter is one of the most populous, as well as coccus and bacillus and phyllus and vibrio. And for the neuter gender, it's, yeah, bacterium and microbium, probably the one of the most famous terminals that we use. So when you form a new name, you could always go to LPSN and have a look at those common terminals. And that could at least provide you already with some ideas what your name could look like, because what you can do is that simply take one of those common terminus and add something before. So that makes your name information easier because, well, first of all, those terminus, we know already the genitive, and then if you name a taxon with those terminus, then it's becoming really easy to form higher taxa because you could just check and, you know, the different higher taxa that are formed from the same from the genera with the same terminus, and you will know how to form your higher taxon. And it also makes your life much easier because it's already providing you with, okay, what is the gender and what it means. So yeah, use it. LPSN it there. Okay, how do I? Right. So let's now have a look at the source of inspiration. Rule 10A of ICNP tell us that the name may be taken from any source and even can be composed in an arbitrary manner. All right. So now you would say, wow, like there are so many rules and now it's and so many limitations, it seems, because when you're submitting your papers and you're naming your taxon and you think, oh yeah, I can use this, I can use that, I can Latinize it this way, but somehow we actually limiting you, but that's not because of the sources, but it's because of the orthography and Latinization rules. So what are the most common sources of names? People like to name after their colleagues, so personal names. People like to name bags under the biological and ecological feature that they see, or the organisms that are associated with geographical location. They also like some allegories and give names of mythological creatures or chemical and pharmaceutical compounds. Sometimes we see also words from other languages, but code is a little bit ambiguous on that side, because it does say that in one of the recommendations that the Latin is preferred language in Greek and Latin is official language. But at the same time, if the words can be taken from any sources, that means they can't be taken from any language. We just need to know how to Latinize it properly. And this is what is the issue sometimes. And arbitrary names as well, of course, that could be just composed out of anything. You can take an abbreviation of your institution and you create new name and bingo, you name it. So here's a slide which is a little bit more populated. and I just will go quickly through it. So here are the formation rules for the name that comes from different sources. And I won't really go into details, but I just want to provide you with some general guidelines. So let's have a look. How do we Latinize personal names? So Latinization of personal names depend on the personal name and endings on the personal name. And such names are always feminine. If you go to LPSN or you can download this paper, so the most common mistake while giving Latin names, that will provide you also with some guidelines as well as the other papers I showed you before. So how you Latinize personal name depending on the endings. Specific epithets also could come from the personal names, but their formation depends on the gender, whether it's a masculine or feminine. And the formation of compound names that come in from personal names were recently standardized, thanks to myself and Aaron. host or host-associated organism. So how do we name it? In many cases, you could just take a Latin name of the host, let's say if it's a dog or if it's a cat or if it's a pig, and just look at the common known which exists in Latin for this animal and then use that. Or you can look at the genus name of the species that actually your host, and then you could preserve the stem of the host Latin name and just, you know, make a compound name, for example, with this. Specific epithets can be also formed from the host associated organism, and those are usually named in a genitive case. So for example, when you say like of certain genus. So geographic location. So it seems to me what I discovered that there is no uniform formation rules for geographic location. And it's something which is really annoying me at the moment. And I would love that we kind of come to some kind of uniform ways. And I hope that we will soon. But usually how you will do it is that you'll try to preserve the name, the stem of locality, and then add the ending to it. Okay, or you will form compound words. For specific epithet from geographic location, you preserve the stem and you just add the ending ensis if it's a masculine or feminine, or ense if it's a neuter gender. So remember that specific epithet have to, if it's an adjective, and usually geographic location will make you adjective, they have to agree with the gender of genus. So if your genus is masculine, it should be ensis. If your genus is neuter, it's ense. If your genus name is feminine, it's ensis again. If it happens that the geographic location ends with A or E, then those vowels are dropped, and then you add in ensis or ense. Okay. Now, physiological or ecological features. So those usually form from the existing oops. Oh, sorry, where it's going? Oh, I can't come back. No. Okay. So yeah, those usually form from existing Latin common nouns, adjectives or verbs, and also could be an allegory using the proper Latin names. Mythological creatures. So those are Latinized normally as a personal Latin names, or sometimes the equivalent actually already exists in Latin dictionaries. So you better check if you want to name something after the goddess, I don't know what, of harvest, please check a Latin dictionary. It might already be there. So you don't need to Latinize it. Then we know a lot of bacterial names that come from the chemical and pharmaceutical compounds. And I believe we might have maybe more of those coming, especially with culturomics and targeted approaches to discover new pharmaceutical compounds. So those are usually formed Latin, from the compound that will be Latinized as a neuter noun with ending -um. And the genitive case is I, meaning that you actually have to drop I, and that will give you a root of your chemical compounds. Arbitrary name, taken from any source, as I said, and they usually resemble to one of the Latin declensions. So with or R ending or us ending, that will correspond to that will advocate for the certain gender of the words. And what's from other languages? Well, first of all, we think about the Greek. and the Greek have specific rules for Latinization. I invite you to explore this a bit more. There is an article, How to Latinize Greek Words, and that may help you. Okay, so let's talk about arbitrary names now. Recently, Mark Palin and his colleagues submitted this paper, which is now accepted to HSM, and they propose in names for taxa in GDDB. That comes from just random Latin resembling roots. And those arbitrary names can actually provide us endless possibility for naming, but at the same time, there might be kind of a Pandora box. Perhaps you know this Greek myth about Pandora, when she opened a box and, you know, all kind of bad things went out of here and caused sickness and death and so on. So, but I don't think that it will cause a sickness or something, but it might provide a little bit of problem, which is not directly linked to the fact of formation of those names, but to the fact of the application, because currently those names are applied to 65,000 taxa in GDDB taxonomy, which makes me a little bit unsettled, because I'm sure there would be many, many of you who would actually love to name this taxa, and you will see that, wow, it's already named. So that's a little bit of controversial approach. And I think that we might convert this Pandora box to something different, to the source of endless possibilities, where instead of applying those names to GDDB taxa, we provide those names to researchers and tell them, look, you can apply, you know, this is a ready to go name. You can apply it to a taxa if you want to. Right. Next, what I'm going to move next. Yeah, I found this article really interesting. Why I'm going to talk about it is just another sources of names, because recently, so those are zoologists and botanists who is trying to advocate for the new attitudes in biological nomenclature, and specifically to bring and enrich nomenclature with culture of native and localized names. And also they're calling for more gender neutral names, which I think it's really, socially speaking, is important to have more gender neutral names. And yeah, think about it. Next slide, I want to talk about the standardization and uniformity in names formation. So as I already told you, so the generic names, we have rules, orthography rules, how to Latinize words from different sources, but there are still some inconsistencies in there, for example, for geographic names and for some other kind of names. So we will try to revise those rules and create uniform guidelines for name information, also for genera. For the classes, standard Latinization rules were proposed in 2011, so not long time ago, actually. And this is why you might find, you know, classes that are not formed in the same manner as other higher taxa. So they, in their roots, actually, they don't connect to the type genus, for example, Delta Proteobacteria, Epsilon Proteobacteria, or some, I don't know, other examples that are not coming to my mind right now. But recently, yeah, so that was standardized, and it is assumed now the ICNP that the class name should be taking the name from the stem of the type order of the, sorry, stem of the type genus of the type order. But that rule was considered as retroactive when it was proposed, but recently it was voted and regarded as non-retroactive in order to preserve existing historical name. And that's also creates some kind of an issues at the moment, but I'm not going to talk about this. I'm going to talk briefly now about phylum. You may know that phylum has been introduced in the prokaryotic, official prokaryotic nomenclature not long time ago in 2021, and that resulted in valid publication of 42 phyla names, which is steered very hot debates. somehow. But I just want to tell you that, you know, regardless of the changes, all we want to do is we really want to come to uniformity here. And I know sometimes it hurts when they change, but you need to remember that in a short time, you know, people will forget about it. And, you know, we will start using those names, and because there will be standard names, it will be much easier to operate, I believe so. And in my last section, I would love to move to the type. In 2019, we published this paper on the importance of designated type material from cultural taxa. And this paper come from our curation struggle when as a GDDB, we apply names to the taxa that we're reclassifying. And in many instances for the candidatus taxa, that was really a nightmare. We didn't know, okay, what should we call it? Oh, there is no type, you know, and we see that the taxa is polyphyletic or they're all intermixed, and which is, we really struggle. So we were trying to come up with different criteria for naming, but then we realized, well, that's not the way forward. You know, the only way forward is to have internationally agreed standards. So Candidatus was introduced in 1994, and that had been around for quite a long time. And not long time ago, in 2016, when Bonnie Whitman suggested that the gene sequences should replace cultures, but you know, maybe be complementary and serve as a type material, but it was unfortunately rejected by the ICSB in 2020. And this led to the formation of the SICOD committee and eventually to the publication of the SICOD just recently and the launch of the SICOD registry. So I'm excited to make this announcement that coming Monday, the SICOD official publication will be out in Nature Microbiology, and I invite you all to read it and to provide us your comment about it. So under the SICOD, names will be anchored to the genomic sequences that will serve as the types. Name will be registered and validated via SICOD registry, and names that are validly published under ICNP will be recognized as well as the priorities. And names can be given to the organisms regardless of the cultivation status. So under the SICOD, you can name either the organisms that is known only through the max or sex, or you can also name an organism which already have a culture. Right, so how that will operate? So the SICOD registry is the main way of operating for the SICOD, and that will provide us a way of capturing all the names. All the names will be indexed and they will be validated through the registry. There are automatic checks as well as curator manual checks will be performed. And I invite you to start using it. Okay, here the website. You can check this later, perhaps, when you will look at the recording. So under the SICOD, there would be different paths of naming validation. At the moment, we only have two passes. So in a blue and an orange, the pink one is a future pass, which we hope will come soon. And the preferred path at the moment is actually going through the blue one. So when your manuscript is in preparation, you can register the names through the SICOD to get the advices and checks from the nomenclature reviewers. And this will allow you to correct the name if it's needed. And then once the publication is out, you add the publication DOI to the registry and that will become validly published. Another way of validating names through the SICOD registry will be through having an existing publication where you might already publish your taxon name, and then you will have to go to the SICOD registry and provide all the information associated with this name, create a record, and that will be, again, checked. You might be contacted with the curators if something has to be modified, and then updated record will be finally, will constitute the final piece and validly published. And the pass, which is anticipated in the future, is the one where we'll have dedicated journal that will be interlinked directly with the registry, and that will allow us to have simultaneous reviews, peer review and SICOD reviews. So like this, there wouldn't be need to, you know, to have this difference, because sometimes it could happen that the name in the publication and name which in the registry could be different. In the past three, that wouldn't happen. Right. So important information that I wanted to tell you about the C code, since it's based on the genomes, is that we adopted the genomic consortium standards to define the quality of the genomes that could be named. And that's quite important because we would like names that are linked to entities which we believe are real, and that the application of the name to the taxa will be as unambiguous as possible. So those standards, that they could be subject to revision in the future, depending on the progress of the field, and they will be reviewed by the standards working group from the C code. They're embedded in the registry checks, and sometimes there could be exception granted to these rules. So I will invite you to look at the standards on Monday when the paper will be officially out. And C code wants you. We need microbiologists from various fields and disciplines because we would like to be a community driving initiative. And if you would love to participate, you can sign up here on our Slack channel. Again, you could look at it later, the recording. And concluding remarks from me. So the art of scientific naming doesn't really require extensive knowledge of Latin, from my experience, but it rather required your knowledge of the rules of orthography, name information, and the ability to read dictionary. Latinization in Latin language is designed for stability and uniformity, and we should carry this principle forward, I believe, in prokaryotic nomenclature, but revisit it where necessary. Adopting uniform formation rules for names from different sources will facilitate naming practice and application of machine learning as well. And new nomenclature code, C code, is out. And yeah, I'm really happy that this initiative was very well supported by the community, but we hope that it will find its way and it will lead finally to the unified naming system for cultured and uncultured prokaryotes. And that's my last slide. And sorry, I might not talk here much. I hope you understand.
Thank you, Maria. Thank you for this wonderful session. I'm sure the participants must have realized that Latin is not necessary language to be actually understanding and naming new species that they really would like to. So the knowledge of orthography is what is essential, and that's the key to naming organisms. Thank you, Maria.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll be happy to take questions and pose questions to you. So we've received a lot of queries on the Q&A box. I've basically ordered them in upvotes. So I'll take the first question first in terms of upvotes. It's from Preben Nielsen. Preben is asking, I often hear that scientists complain that bacterial names are hard to pronounce, remember, and not very practical. I understand that we currently use correct Latin for naming and see a point in this. But if we don't create names that are practically applicable, I see a risk for use of slang. Do you see any solutions to this?
Yeah, that's actually a good question. And I believe in the paper from that I just show you on arbitrary names, they actually try to tackle this issue. And they look at the phonetics really carefully so that the names, that the new names that are formed that are easily that pronounceable and that are sounding nicely. But yeah, perhaps we could also implement this checks of, of phonetics and syllabification when we form in new names. And currently we don't have really a tool. So I know that that's been based on the machine learning approach again to check all the phonetics, like embedded rules of phonetics to check those names, that syllables that are coming from Latin, that they are nicely can be nicely pronounced, and let's say so. Yeah, I would say it's better to avoid names that are difficult to pronounce, and this is one of the main issue why we advocate to use Latin rather than other languages, because when you use other languages, the issue is that a lot of them might lack vowels And that creates complication when you try to pronounce them.
Right. The next question comes from Phil from the next room. Do you find the arbitrary names memorable? Are they more memorable than placeholder names?
Well, I think it's really, you know, some of them I found that they could be memorable because they're really, they're nice names. There is nothing bad with them. It's just that you need to create association. And that's the thing. I think that's the key thing. Because when we have a name and we know that associated with something, with certain, I don't know, properties, with a paper that we learn. Because you could same, you could look at any word. If it's a new one, let's say, you know, we didn't know the bacillus when the bacillus name was introduced, you know, like if there was no association, what it is, like, how do you memorize it? You know, so I think same for arbitrary names. Some of them are really nice, but unless you have this association with it, it might be the reason why you could struggle with memorizing.
Okay. The next one is actually just a addition of new information and actually very critical information from Aaron Oren. And he writes, concerning the candidatus concept, it may be nice to remember that this was started by Bob Murray, who actually passed away a few months ago at the age of 103, approximately. It's really commendable that people with such knowledge are not there with us anymore. But without Bob Murray's contribution in the field, I think the candidatus would be lost in data itself and not being seen the eyes of the researchers. So thank you, Aaron, for adding this piece of information.
Shall I comment?
Yes, absolutely, please.
Yeah, so I would love that we preserve candidatus names as much as possible because there is a big record of those names. And there is also, you know, in terms of association with those names, you know, people operate with them since very long time, since 1994 at least. So the idea is actually if we could translate those names into C code names and validate them and, you know, attach them to the genomic sequences, that would be the way also to stabilize the nomenclature of candidatus. If there would be culture isolate that could be also, you know, attached to like the candidatus name that could be attached to the culture, that will be also a way to keep this historical record. So hopefully that will stay and we could make this translation.
Correct. Yeah. Brevin has another question that's been upvoted very recently. So for many of us, access to type strain cultures is important. Do you see any solutions to stimulate continued deposition of type material in the future?
To stimulate? Well, I believe that, you know, the culturing won't stop. And because we all know that the cultures are important, that the only way we could actually test experimentally, you know, our hypothesis. Everything that is predicted bioinformatically only can be tested experimentally in a lab if you have the organism itself.
Right.
And I hope with the recent publication from the Japanese group, I don't know if you've seen that one on the new cultivation approaches, I hope that this will also stimulate, you know, and open new possibility because obviously, like when we have a mag or sac, you know, and we can't do that much, you know, in terms of testing and see the real physiology of these organisms. Mm-hmm. So the cultures will be always valuable, I believe so. And we shouldn't neglect it. And just the fact that you could name a taxon based on the genomic sequence, this genomic sequence can come from the poor culture. And the poor culture could be still deposited. So that doesn't, it shouldn't diminish the value of the cultures. You know, it should complement. It should be just a way to, you know, to align taxonomy and nomenclature because current taxonomy is built on genomes. And if we can also build nomenclature based on genomes, we could align those two more together so we can avoid creation of useless names, but could avoid creation of many synonyms. But most importantly, we could have this record, which is easily accessible to everyone compared to the cultures.
Right. I mean, just to add a comment, when the the idea was floated about using genomic sequences as type material. One of the biggest concerns raised by many of the opponents was that the enthusiasm to cultivate organisms will die out if we allow genomic sequences to be used as type material. But I think that instead that will actually encourage people to cultivate more, because then you have authenticated type material genomic sequences available to you to actually help cultivation of all these uncultivated organisms.
Exactly. Yeah, that will be, you know, that will be facilitate the targeted cultivation approaches.
Right. Yeah. So the next one comes from Phil again, and Phil is asking, C-code automatically accepts names validly published under the ICNP. Will this be reciprocated?
Well, that's a good question. And I don't think that it will be reciprocated in the near future, but I hope perhaps in a few years. It all will depend on the implementation of the C code, you know, how this initiative will work. And I think the future will show us.
Yeah.
Because, at the moment, you know, since the ICNP voted down, there is no way kind of to, again, start voting on it. So the only way to go forward, I believe, is to start naming and culture taxa, and for us recognizing the name formed under ICNP, and that eventually ICNP will realize that, ICSP, that this initiative is not hampering and is not hazardous to them, but it's actually complementary.
Right. Just to add for the participants' information, the 1980 list of validly published taxa names, which was the first list that came out, I think that is already automatically accepted by the C code. So there is no need for those registrations to be done in the C code registry, if I'm not wrong, right?
All the names that are, they will be recognized. They're not registered there, I believe, not all of them, but
So another question comes from Xianhao Lu, from China, I believe, and the question is there any guideline for the usage of C code?
Guidelines, yeah. Well, this is something that we're actually working on. You have guidelines in the paper. So when the paper will be out, you will see there are actually guidelines. But we're also working on the guidelines that will be uploaded to the website. And those will be video tutorials and perhaps just some step-by-step or frequently asked questions guidelines. But you will also find the guidelines in the paper that will come up on Monday.
Okay.
So you will be able to figure out what to do.
Okay. The next question comes from Professor Devananda from Manipur University in India. The question is, how do you decide if name endings must be in masculine or feminine form? And thank you for the illuminating lecture, Maria. That's the comment.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. Well, this decision really comes from the word itself. You know, if you use the common Latin noun, usually the dictionary will tell you whether it's a noun in masculine or feminine gender or neuter gender. Then if you're forming names from other sources, which are not coming from the proper Latin names, let's say you're forming new Latin name, in such cases, you will look, for example, if it's a personal name, personal generic names, they're usually femina gender. And there are guidelines for this. So in my lecture, I did suggest that Hans Trooper paper helps with Latin, or an LPSN you can find. So personal names, they are always femina for the... then for compounds from chemistry, for example, Zusanita, usually Latinized. And so again, it's come to orthography, but if it's a common Latin name, the gender is always indicated in a dictionary. So you could just check the dictionary and it will be written whether the noun is femina or mascula.
Okay.
Yeah.
The next is actually a suggestion from Aaron. Aaron says the second option to form adjectives is a noun in apposition, not a noun in opposition, which is the rule 12C2 from the nomenclature code.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I believe I had it. Yeah, I had it and for specific epithets. Yeah. Right. So it could be genitive or noun opposition. Yeah. So then you don't need, like, it could be, yeah, you don't need agreement in the gender with the genus names.
Okay. This is probably the last question and comes from someone in India, because Sanskrit as a language, and it's an anonymous question, Sanskrit as a language forms the basis of many of the dialects in India. So especially in many of the English words are actually taken from Sanskrit. So the question actually relates to this and whether Sanskrit is able to replace Latin or Greek if needed.
Well, I don't think it will be able to replace, but generally, like strictly speaking, you can actually use it according to the code, you know, because the code tell you you can use any source. But then the question comes, okay, whether it's really pronounceable and how to Latinize it. Is it will it be easy to Latinize? So you need to determine the stem of that word, you know, you need to translate it to English. And so, yeah, I mean, it practically speaking, it can be used. Yeah, definitely. But I don't think it will replace Latin. I mean, even Latin is that language. We use it because they're uniform. It's, you know, it's there, and there is an endless source also of stems and roots that could help us to form new names. Yeah. So I don't think there is a need to kind of bring another language.
Just to add on this, basically. So like matre is the word for mother in Sanskrit, and matre becomes mother in English and mata becomes in Hindi. So it's very synonymous, and the stems of mata stays the same, and it's basically changed depending on the
Well, you can Latinize it. Yeah, yes. You can also Latinize it. So it's kind of it's a false Latin name.
Yes.
Okay. But that's possible. So that's actually not forbidden. It's not recommended, because recommended is Latin Greek, but it is possible. So yeah, we can't, you know, remove this possibility.
Yeah. So thank you, Maria, for this extremely interactive session and answering all the questions of the participants and actually sharing resources throughout your talk that will be actually very useful for our beginners and participants who are actually very excited to learn the field of etymology and orthography for naming new organisms. I would like to take this opportunity to also tell about the next speaker on 15th of October. Professor Patrick Fortier has kindly agreed. We will be starting a new topic for discussion, that is the tree of life and the evidences for ancient genes exchange between the Ascard archaea and the proto-eukaryotes. So it's about the new sort of route to the life, to the tree of life, and how prokaryotic and eukaryotic evolution has shaped up the field of science. So Professor Patrick Fortier will be speaking on 15th of October, and we hope to have more attendance of participation as we have had in the past. Thank you, Maria, for this wonderful session, and we'll see you all next month. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everyone. Thanks.